especially in times like this, telemedicine has definitely branched out and became an extension of medicine more so than what it normally would. With the current pandemic reaching record highs and people still in need of medication refills, assessments, and doctor's appointments, telehealth has been there to step in to continuously provide ways for providers to still be able to do what they love and enjoy while serving their patients. In many ways, telehealth is an essential. It is contributing to the precautions and the restrictions of COVID-19 in ways that we're keeping providers and current healthcare workers safe, as well as patients, with being able to do telehealth from home or from the doctor's office to the patient's home. It still allows us to refill all medications. In my world, we're still seeing new patients as well as established patients. So it gives the patients the opportunity and the flexibility as well to schedule appointments and be seen like they normally would in the doctor's office from their home. So currently for me, I have adjusted and shifted into my new role as a healthcare provider. And what do I mean by that? So normally I am outpatient regardless. I do not work in a hospital, but working from home you would think would be an easy adjustment, but it has not. Then, for instance, I do all of my own admin work. I don't schedule my own patients, but I am in charge for creating things like my billing sheet and little things that I would normally care less or don't think twice about. The way I communicate with insurance companies looks a little different now because I don't have a fax machine at home. And so calling insurance companies and communicating with them, completing prior authorizations via phone, it looks a little bit different. I have definitely learned to appreciate, number one, my admin. I've always appreciated them, but my admins. And the joy and the luxury of having a fax machine, because I don't have that at home. My role as a healthcare provider has not necessarily changed, right? I mean, my role is essentially still the same mission, same philosophy, same work ethic. But my work ethic has kind of tweaked or kind of shifted a little bit with working from home. I do have added responsibilities that I would not have had to worry about in office. I just recently mentioned with the fax machine and the billing sheets and things like that. So I am required to create all of my documents, and otherwise I would not have had to worry about that because my admin and my office manager take care of that for me. So I say my philosophy, you know, how I treat patients, things like that, that respect I give, that empathy I give, has not necessarily changed from what it was in the beginning, but I can definitely say I can empathize with my patients way more. There is a lot going on with this pandemic. A lot of people have lost loved ones recently. They are personally or being personally affected by COVID-19, and a lot of my patients have lost jobs. COVID-19 is a very real nightmare for a lot of people and for a lot of my patients. They're going through a lot of struggles during this time. The most common complaint that I have been having during these last 3 months is increasing anxiety and worry and panic. And I think that's something that all of us feels at this time. So I have really been spending extra time with my patients, each and every one of them, which can be kind of hard when you're seeing close to 25, sometimes close to 30 people a day from home. But nonetheless, I love what I do, and I couldn't imagine doing anything else. Some days are harder than others, and I do miss peer interaction, you know, being able to speak to my colleagues, being able to leave the house, have that time en route to work, to myself, and be able to listen to my favorite podcast and things like that. So being that I'm working from home, I have no reason to leave the house unless I have to go to the grocery store or the pharmacy, just like as recommended. And so even though things are starting to open back up in my state, in Virginia, we're opening back up on Wednesday, which will be July the 1st. And so I have a lot of mixed feelings about that. I'm probably going to do a second video on COVID-19 precautions and the seriousness of this. But at this point, I'm just going to say I really don't feel like it's safe for people to be reopening, just because we're kind of still in the same state as we were when we shut down. There's no treatment, there's nothing out there for this, and we're learning day by day more and more that COVID-19 is causing a lot of manifestations. It's a lot. I mean, like I said previously, I know if I've spoken to some of you guys, medicine has no idea what we're dealing with this virus. The whole world is trying to understand and figure it out and get it down to a science. And every day something new comes out, because that's just how it works when you're studying something. And we're behind the ball compared to a lot of countries. And, you know, I digress. But back to the purpose of this video. So, I will definitely say the pros, of course, saving gas, saving money on eating out for lunch because my kitchen is right around the corner from my computer room. Being able to dress lightly. I mean, sometimes you just put on a shirt and some sweatpants because people are only going to see you from the waist up. I mean, having all that luxury is wonderful. Controlling what you're able to eat, your water intake, all that is great. My cons, or some of my worry, or how long this is going to be lasting, is not being able to see my whole patient. Like, I examine people with my eyeballs from head to toe, and I do a complete assessment, and I feel like it's harder to not only connect when you're doing psychiatry over the computer screen or through a phone, but it's also harder to be able to fill your patient out. Limited with the computer screen, and I have definitely ran into a couple of difficult things. Like, for instance, everybody knows that psychiatry and addiction medicine goes hand in hand, and I have encountered a couple of that has not been completely honest, and I had to find things out the hard way. And so as I'm learning how to navigate this whole thing from home, working from home and doing telehealth, I would definitely say for psychiatry and addiction medicine, it is kind of hard because I don't have the luxury of going across the hall, grabbing a urine cup and saying, hey, can you provide a urine sample for me? Or I don't have the luxury of going to grab the swab, the oral swabs, and saying, hey, you know, let's do a quick oral swab, da da da, because that is routine for me. Regardless, before they even step back in my office, that's the drill. That's my protocol. It's up to each provider in the office. I mean, they do what they feel, but I check the VA PMP, and I get oral swabs on everybody regardless. And so it's really hard because in psychiatry, the only thing you have to go off of is their history and their word. And just to be completely honest, all of your patients are not honest. Some of them will try to get what they want, and they have other agendas. I've really had a heart-to-heart with people and just let them know, you're not going to get it here. At this point, just not being able to do my drug screening and my labs. So people who have, of course, are taking lithium Depakote, or who have probably tried every mood stabilizer there is except for lithium and Depakote, and that requires blood work, and I'm kind of put in a bind in a way because I can't start those without being able to get my blood work in 4 weeks. And there's no telling where we're going to be in 4 weeks or what's going to be open in 4 weeks. And it depends on where they're living in the state and what primary care provider they use and if that office takes blood or if they're doing specimens. And so it's like this whole dilemma. LabCorps and other outsourced places that take blood specimens and acts, and they've been pretty cooperative. Even primary care providers have been very nice in ordering my labs, because usually primary care is just like, they can get their own labs, they can go to LabCorp or different things like that. Not every primary care, but some do not like to do outside labs for other providers. So during this time, I can definitely say we're all on one accord in a way, and they have been working with me and it has been nice. But for some people, for a small percentage of people, that's not how it went down. And that's not what we were able to do, and so we had to get real creative and try other things, but it all worked out. Well, in other areas besides psychiatry, like family medicine, chronic pain management, cardiology, to name a few, dermatology, some urgent care centers are also doing telehealth. So I would definitely say that it has expanded the reach. Telehealth is something that's always been around. I don't know if you have seen my previous video that I put out on telehealth or telemedicine. I talked about how long that it's actually been around. Pandemics like this, this is definitely the opportune time to utilize it. And I would definitely say I see it's more common than not, and a lot of places are actually thinking about just keeping it permanently, like even when they open back up, still having telehealth option to reach people who may not be in the area, these far out in rural communities and things like that. So it's definitely a tool, and I definitely hear a lot of patients say, yeah, I saw my chronic pain management the other day and we had a telehealth appointment through Skype or Zoom or whatever. And it's definitely been helpful to give us a continuation of our purpose to continuously serve our community while protecting ourselves and protecting our patients. So I would definitely say I see from ages 5 and up, which I've told you guys before, and a lot of my patients are geriatric patients with a lot of health conditions. So it's helpful to know that I'm protecting them and myself from the virus. Happy. I'm blessed that I'm still working, that my job has not been affected, my finances have not been affected by the pandemic. I thank God every day for that, because I know for a lot of you guys that's not the case. So while I try not to complain, because to be honest, compared to other people, I really don't have anything to complain about. And so I really try to stay positive and thankful and grateful and use what I have to be able to help others. That's how I'm getting through this time. That's where my mind is mentally, guys. I really just want to say thank you to all of the frontline workers. I'm talking about the grocery store workers, the sanitation workers, the public place where you have to have interaction with the public. Retail is now opening back up, so I'm talking about the mall. I mean, all of us in ways are frontline workers. We are serving the public, and when you think about it, I mean, in the grocery stores, the pharmacies, I mean, all of us, yes. But when you think about all of the groups of people that it encompasses, like all of us are working together to be able to give some type of service to the public, that qualifies as frontline workers. And I pray for all of us every night that your health is protected, that your job and security is protected, and that more jobs do not close down due to the pandemic. These are some uncertain times that we live in right now, but also there's a lot of good that's coming from it. And so I just want to urge you guys to continue to stay positive and continue to find the light in the little things, and continue to let that light guide you until your mind is just set on the bigger things or the bigger picture later on down the line, or your purpose that you serve during this time, and let that continue to keep you going. Well, guys, I will say that's it for this video today. I am going to come through with another video on the pandemic precautions and how I feel about states reopening, which I gave you a little snippet of earlier, but I'm kind of going to go into more detail and more depth. I'm still working on the racism and mental health, or African Americans and mental health, Black mental health. I'm not really sure what I'm gonna name it yet, but I am definitely gonna do a video. Do not know if it's gonna be a series yet, but I definitely want to talk to you guys on a real basis, on some real, like, one-on-one new. But I'm so glad that things are coming in the light that has been in the dark for so many years, and now it feels like we're making some change. I hope that you have enjoyed this video. If you have, please like it, give it a thumbs up, subscribe, hit the bell notification so every time that I have an upload, your phone, your computer, whatever you have will notify you that I am back. And I have a new video and you have to come and check it out. You have to come and support my community. I love you guys. I thank you for your constant support, and I will see you guys later. Bye guys.